Right. Hello, good morning, Jan Peter.
Hello.
Great to have you with us here today. Thank you for joining this conversation. So I'm now with Jan Peter Domernik, who is a senior business developer within asset management at Enexis in the Netherlands. So thanks for joining us, Jan Peter. You're speaking at our Grid Asset Management conference at the end of September on the subject of disruptive technologies and what this means for the future of Enexis and the grid. So tell us a bit more about the work that you're doing on a day-to-day basis around this.
What we are doing on a day-to-day basis with this is co-creating with different partners on understanding how to handle the fact that we as a critical infrastructure are vital for a society, but we have to be future-proof and nobody knows the future. So in the future, there are a lot of things we can predict, we can model, but there will always be the unexpected. How to handle the unexpected? What are the elements that create the unexpected? For us, are very important. So basically, what are our blind spots? And what are the questions that we can ask to unveil them so that we can be prepared and develop a skill to handle those unexpected elements in our future?
Mm-hmm. What are some of the unexpected things that you're focusing on right now? What are the areas that you're really digging into to prepare for the unexpected?
The unexpected, the reason why you do not expect things is because you come off out of a certain mindset. So if I look at our asset management, we really love ecosystems that work. We focus a lot on them.
Yeah.
But if you look how other parties behave, they like to stretch ecosystems the max to get the maximum value out of them. Mm-hmm. So although they are partners in our industry, they are looking at the system to get completely different things out of it. And that could lead to unexpected results. Mm-hmm. So if you take, for example, we all love clean energy. And we love solar, we love wind. But we also know that we have a problem sometimes if we have energy on places where we do not need it, and we want to get energy to places where it isn't. So we are talking to partners about trading in flexibility.
Yes. Yeah.
But one of the challenges of flexibility is that it has the most value if our system has the biggest problem. Mm-hmm. And if you then think about that something artificial like AI could assist in flexibility markets, and a party would ask the AI, okay, create the maximum value, the maximum money I can get out of it if I trade my flexibility, then the AI and its interaction with systems could lead to situations where we bring the whole system into problems, mm-hmm. because then there it has the maximum value.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And some of the magic happens if you realize that as an asset manager, you automatically focus on the things you can see. That's data, that is the stability in the system. Those are things you really like. Mm-hmm. But data is the story of what has happened yesterday. So it's not always the best way to predict what could happen. Mm-hmm. But what we also see is that there is some trends focusing on orchestration of energy usage. So that could be on storage, that could be in virtual power plants. So we've heard, for example, that Bosch, together with Grid Singularity, are working on systems to enable micro trading behind the meter. So it is invisible for us.
Yeah.
But that bears two risks in it. So as soon as we get dependent on this kind of trading, we get kind of a numb because all our problems get solved for us. Mm-hmm. And the second risk is that because of the orchestration, it's no longer behaving like it's random.
Mm-hmm.
And if you take this randomness out of the equation, it's counterintuitive. But the systems on those days could behave as complex systems on organized complexity. And in organized complexity, what happens is counterintuitive.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah, yeah. So it's like one step towards more chaos or handling more chaos, but then because you rein it in and organize it, it goes back to certainty again. So it's almost like a dance between certainty and uncertainty. What's the biggest challenge that you have in moving towards this slightly more dynamic environment? What's the challenge you have in paving the way towards that and really retaining the traits of a dynamic grid without trying to rein it in too much, but ensuring energy security at the same time?
The biggest challenge we have is that we tend to look at stability because this is what we can see, this is what we can grasp. Mm-hmm. But what you're looking for is resilience.
Yeah.
The skill to handle different situations, and the skill is a thing you cannot see.
Yes.
And the skill is not a skill of a control system.
Mm-hmm.
We look a lot, for example, at nature, because you see all those systems balancing each other out, and there is no a super control entity, but it are skills and normally simple rules that make very complex structures possible. If you, for example, look at an anthill, then the ant hill, there's no super ant who has control. All the ants just do their things, but it's one of the most stable structures that we know. But one of the things there is that in an anthill you have different roles. So you have the role of, for example, protector. But let's say there is a big blow of wind. All the protectors were at the top and they were blown away.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that there is a big problem now, because all the ants, if they meet each other, they sniff each other. And if they haven't sniffed a protector for 2 minutes, they become the protector.
Right.
So the system is again stable after 2 minutes. It has the same resilience.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But if McKinsey would go to an anthill, and we talk a lot, of course, with consultancy companies, then they would look at the anthill and they would say, yeah, but there are a lot of ants, they are doing nothing. Let's be cost effective and get rid of them.
Right.
And then we are doing something good because we are not spending too much money, but we are also making the system brittle. But the brittleness we only would notice as soon if there's something happening that we didn't foresee.
Right.
And being able to handle things we are not able to foresee is... We are now during COVID.
Mm-hmm.
4 months ago, nobody would have said, okay, be prepared for a gigantic flu epidemic.
Mm-hmm.
But if you now look, there is some level of societal rest, because there are essential functions like energy, like water, like having access to food, that still function.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine what would happen if those systems would have broken down also, then the unrest in society would have been completely different. So to ensure to be future proof, there are a lot of areas where you can look, where the way that you perceive the system, you perceive what could be happening, is colored in by your starting point. and where the being able to ask questions beyond those starting points, and the questions that are seldomly or never asked, enable you to see things that were never seen. And besides society, then of course we have technology, and in technology, people now can train AIs for 200 years to learn a skill, because it doesn't have to be in serial. You can train the AI in parallel, so you can create functions that are unimaginable, but today we can prove that we can do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I like the distinction you make between stability and resilience. I think that's really important. And the fact that we see so much resilience in nature. Nature is such a great system to emulate, really, in any resilience system that we want to develop. So what's been the effect of COVID on the work that you do at Inexis? How has this impacted you? Has it been largely, has it had a positive or a negative impact? And have you been able to leverage any opportunities out of it?
As always, it had some positive impact and some negative impact. What we do, because we are focusing on the questions that are actually too big for one grid operator, but what are essential for all grid operators. And we even took it a step further. We found out that the questions we are asking are essential for all critical infrastructures. So we created a team with the Ministry of Infrastructure, the Ministry of Defense, the Dutch Water Authority, the DOMMEL, to ask ourselves the question, what do systems need to be resilient? What are the blind spots in our joint thinking, and what are the causes of our joint problems? Because you would think those infrastructures have different goals, but we found out that we share the same problems.
Yes.
We do this in co-creation with the smartest AI and blockchain teams of the world. So we have a joint challenge on the biggest blockchain and AI hackathon of the world. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, if you think COVID, there was a challenge. Because bringing international people together in one place is now not happening anymore. So we had some postponement. And we are now rethinking this event of giant momentum, how it could happen in an online way. And this rethinking, because it's a sudden change of environment, which of course for us is very inspiring, because those are the unexpected changes we basically thrive on. But we see that in interaction also a lot differs. Normally with the teams, we have a pressure cooker situation of 7 weeks where what we were doing in the talk, this rethinking about the unimaginable, the things you cannot see, the things you deem normal, and how you ask questions to see new elements of reality. In a pressure cooker, this can be done in a very nice way. Now we have 7 months to prepare for the event in November. So what we are now doing now is explaining more the scientific basis of the lenses we are looking through, more of a connection to the team. We are writing it out more in articles, or opening up for a different reality also has to do with storytelling. So we create a lot of movies that help people to get in the right mindset, right, to really gather together and make future-proof solutions. And that is one nice thing that we found out, that if you want to become a billionaire, you are alone. But if you want to make the world a more secure place, future-proof, beneficial for all, you have a lot of friends also in unexpected places. They all want to help.
Yes. Yeah.
And yeah. This is amazing and really makes it a great story, a great exploration to be part of.
Yes.
And the super value thing is that we found out a lot of questions. After my session, my colleague Leonard Lalieu will come up. And he will say, okay, the exploration team found some questions. And then we took the new realms they revealed about artificial intelligence. And we start looking in our company, how can we enhance our operating skills already on today? So not preparing for the unimaginable, but become a more stronger entity today using AI.
Yes. Yeah, fantastic. Fascinating. Well, we're looking forward to hearing more about the projects you're working in the September event on grid asset management. But on a personal level, JP, who's inspired you the most in your career?
There are a lot of people, but incredible, powerful inspiration was Harari, when on page 126 of the book Sapiens, mm-hmm. he writes about imagined orders.
Uh-huh.
And imagined order is the way that we as human, we shape our society. And we create things that are true and that aren't. Mm-hmm. And if you go back in time, mm-hmm. then religion was a very big part of the imagined order. And people lived because they wanted to go to heaven. So if they made concepts in their head, that was a big part of the concepts. Mm-hmm. Then, of course, the world started changing and became in a new imagined order. Yeah. If you look outside, there's COVID. 250 years ago, we would have been burning witches now, because everybody would know this is witchcraft. And what do you have to do if you have to fight witchcraft?
Mm-hmm.
Making me aware that we are also in an imagined order today was a very powerful challenge to start to hunt for paradigms, to look for the things we deem normal but are actually crazy. There are a lot of orthodoxies, a lot of things that people first believe, and if time goes on, it changes and we start a new belief. What is this mechanism?
Mm-hmm. Yeah?
Thomas Kuhn wrote a brilliant book, How This Happened in Science and How Science Evolves.
Mm-hmm.
So although the words sometimes seem mystical, they're also very accessible for an engineer.
Mm-hmm.
You just have to think a bit longer and ask a bit of more questions, yeah, before you go to the solution phase.
Right. It sounds like you draw on influences from quite a wide range of areas in life. That's fascinating, JP.
Yeah.
Interesting. And so what does JP do in your downtime, in your spare time, when you're not at work, when you're not seeing the future, as it were?
I'm a bit afraid that this exploration is so fascinating.
Yeah.
That it is a thing you do continuously.
Yeah.
As I was young, my dad gave me the book about Heinrich Schliemann, because he loved archaeology.
Uh-huh.
And Heinrich Schliemann took the old books, like the Odyssey, like the Ilias, and he was reading them as an engineer. And he said, well, if this is true, then this can't be true. And he started a quest for finding the city of Troya, but he looked in Turkey and he found the gold mask of Agamemnon, as it's now called. So being able to take the books think as an engineer, mm-hmm. and to find out, okay, find the treasure of a future we can all build on. We just have to really read the books, really understand what the people are saying, to find the conflicts and then to start for the questions. Mm-hmm. That is an endeavor I also do in my free time, but I love that I can do it as my work, because in my work I can ensure that all the people will have energy always and it will be as clean as possible. And this is an energy that I find in all the people at the Nexus, but also in all the people that are working on grids and thinking about the future.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's a great time to be alive.
Absolutely. And it sounds like for you, there's no divide between work and life in general. It's all one seamless experience for you and one seamless journey. Yeah.
Yeah, that's maybe that nature inspired me a bit too much, because there are no animals that at 5 o'clock say, okay, I stop doing the things I don't like because now I have time to do the things I do like. I think that's very wise, and that's how I maybe came to that idea.
I know, I totally agree. I think that work should just be part of life, and that actually work is our craft and it's our connection with the world and our fascination as well. Wonderful. Well, it's great talking to you, JP, and we really look forward to your session at the Grid Asset Management Conference at the end of September, and wish you all the best with the work you're doing at Nexus now. It sounds absolutely fascinating. Really great to talk to you today.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. See you very soon.
See you very soon.